For centuries, Buddhists and non-Buddhists alike have used the words Buddha and Buddhism to describe a message of Buddha, but many do not actually know the exact meanings of these words, and therefore, whether one or the other word has any relevance to the message of Buddha. The real meanings of these words open up only within the scope of two very important processes, namely experiencing and seeing, which leads to a state known as enlightenment. In fact, without these two parameters of experiencing and seeing, there is no enlightenment and there is no teaching of Buddha. There have been no enlightened ones recorded in the history in the past 2100 years or so, certainly not in hundreds, thousands, or in hundreds of thousands as were known before that time. There may be vague instances where others have thought that somebody was enlightened, but nobody seemed to have experienced and seen, so that the message of enlightenment could be passed down to help others to achieve the same. There are, of course, various descriptions of such a state in ancient texts, but no results for over 2 millennia. In the absence of results, and therefore clarity, it is natural in such circumstances for various communities to separate themselves into different groups, sometimes mixed with their cultural aspects of various countries, emphasizing or highlighting a particular aspect of the message they feel is important, or a particular path they think is essential. Such groups are widely well known and have gone to form various traditions and branches of what is known as Buddhism, namely Mahayana, Theravada, Vajrayana, Zen, Pure Land, and many others. Forgive me if I have not mentioned others, but all of them essentially constitute various aspects of thought-mediated understanding without much success in achieving enlightenment. Those thought-mediated understandings have collectively come to be known as Buddhism. However, all of them know that there could be only one message, although there could be at least two methods that could be employed to progress in the one and the only path towards the pinnacle of full enlightenment. So why have not people been able to achieve enlightenment for the past 2100 years or so? How could we break this trend and awaken with enlightenment? As I go along, you'll be able to understand why we haven't had positive results and explore, open up and revive the path which became unclear with the arrival of a religion called Buddhism over 2 millennia ago. The first thing one must do is to understand the strict meanings of the words we use commonly in describing the path. Buddha is the first word we come across when we start to explore. Buddhism is the second word we encounter. I will discuss Buddhism in my next talk. Let us investigate the strict or the real meaning of this word and see whether this is the way you understood Buddha before. It is a word originated from ancient Indian languages and is a combination of two components, Bud, B-U-D-D, and Tha, T-H-A. Bud means supreme knowledge or supreme intelligence, also known as supra-mundane intelligence. Tha means arisen from within. So Buddha means supreme intelligent or supreme knowledge arisen from within. This is in contrast to acquired knowledge from outside, usually through the process called thinking by using the five senses. Therefore, the first thing one must know is that the word Buddha in its strictest sense is not referring to a person called Buddha. The second thing one must know is that the knowledge is not acquired through thinking, arguing, criticizing, or writing theses in universities. Unfortunately, in Buddhism, the word Buddha always refers to a person, but not to the state of supreme intelligence, which it should be. For the moment, it should be noted that this state of knowledge or intelligence is not wisdom, as used in day-to-day language. And in fact, much further from it. This supreme knowledge arising within is also called Bodhi in ancient Indian Magadhi language. Let us now look at what this supreme knowledge is and what it is about. This knowledge is unique in that it is the knowledge about reality and beyond reality. What then is reality in a Buddhist sense? It is the ultimate, and I mean the ultimate, building blocks of nature, so tiny that they cannot be divided into matter any further. If one attempts to divide them any further, there would be no reality left when it is called Nibbana. Nibbana is a word used in Magadhi language and Nirvana in Sanskrit. That is the supreme knowledge or the state of Buddha. Because this state of reality and beyond reality, and for that matter, the path to arrive in such a state is not a religion, anybody irrespective of their religions can achieve this state. That means anybody can become supremely intelligent if they understand and progress in the path. This state of Nirvana or Nibbana is therefore beyond reality. This is the ultimate truth, beyond which there is no more to be known. It is this state of Nibbana that is called the state of supreme knowledge or supreme intelligence or simply Buddha or Bodhi. As I mentioned earlier, Nibbana or supreme knowledge can only arise from within and cannot be achieved through thinking. The thought process involves gathering information from outside with the aid of five senses and memory, and this information is used to compute into ideas, theories and laws, etc. On the other hand, supreme intelligence arises only one way, that is arising from within. This happens only when the thought process is abolished. That means that the supreme intelligence or supreme knowledge, Buddhi, Nibbana or Buddha, whatever you call it, cannot exist side by side with the thought process. You will understand why this is so as we go along. The process of thinking always, and I mean always, leads to an illusion, and therefore such a person can never reach reality or the ultimate truth, Nirvana. The thinking process acquires knowledge from outside through information fed via the five senses and memory to a unit called the mind. In other words, all the wires from these six organs are connected at the other end to the mind, which with the help of memory computes to produce thoughts and ideas, which are illusions and is exactly opposite to reality and Nibbana. This is one of the most important fundamental truths to learn at the very beginning in the path to intelligence, that however wisely one thinks, the thought process always produces an illusion, but not reality. Thinking wisely involving the mind, in Buddhist circles known as Yoniso Manasikara, to achieve Nibbana is the hallmark of the religion called Buddhism. And you will see why this actually leads you towards illusion rather than Nibbana. This is one of the reasons why there have been no enlightened ones in the last two millennia. You will understand as we go along with examples as to why and how a thought always produces an illusion. I mentioned the word mind earlier, and it might make some scientists anxious as they have not yet found an entity called the mind from their experiments. Although there exists a specialty in medicine called psychiatry, which deals with diseases of the mind, scientists have various theories, again through thinking, where it could be situated and have a tendency to think that the brain is part of the mind, or mind is situated in the brain. But for our purposes, mind is a separate entity and not the brain. The brain, of course, is a part of the physical body. There is no memory in the mind. This is very important to know because most Eastern religions, including Buddhism, consider memory to be situated in the mind. Memory is in fact situated in the brain, which is part of the physical body. As we all know, that if a part of the brain that stores memory is damaged or removed by surgery, one loses the portion of the memory stored in the damaged or removed part of the brain. The reality of the mind is something that will be seen during the early stages in the path to enlightenment. And without it being seen, not only will one have no knowledge about reality, but mind can never be conquered to abolish the thought process. I hope to discuss the mind on another occasion later. The reality of the mind cannot be reached through thinking or experiments done by using equipment produced using the thinking process, because thinking ultimately shows only an illusion and not the reality. Why do I call thinking, which happens as a result of what we see, hear, touch, smell, or taste, illusions? Let me give you some examples. When we see through our normal eyes, we see people, trees, houses, roads, etc. But never can the eyes show the ultimate building blocks of these objects. It is the same for other senses and memory. Firstly, they are not powerful enough to see reality. Secondly, the information from these sense organs are fed to this unit called the mind, which only knows to produce an illusion called a thought. Say, if we replace our eyes with X-ray eyes, what will we see then? Through the X-ray eyes, we will perhaps see people mainly as a collection of bones or skeletons. If we replace our eyes with radio wave eyes, we will not see people, trees, or houses, because radio waves pass through them. We will not see even our own bodies. It'll be a completely different world compared to what we see through our normal eyes. Do our eyes tell us the truth about the nature? The answer is no. Here is another example. When we see leaves on trees as of green color, are they actually green? Is it the truth? We know that the white light from the sun is a mixture of seven different colors, just like we see in a rainbow. When these seven colors fall on a leaf, all the colors except green are absorbed by the leaf. Because green is not absorbed, it is reflected off the surface of the leaf and falls on our eyes. The eyes then pass this information to the mind, which interprets it as green. Whereas in fact, the leaf actually contains all the other colors absorbed into it, except green. The mind, with the help of the eyes and light, fools us to believe that the leaf is green. This, therefore, is an illusion. This means the thought mechanism we use to run our day-to-day lives is inadequate to reach knowledge about reality and nirvana, which is the ultimate truth, the state of Buddha. In fact, we are misguided by this thought mechanism to accept illusions as truth. Now you begin to wonder, how on earth can we live without thinking? A fact most people do not know is that when the thinking process stops, a new eye opens up. This new eye, without a physical structure, but still sees, is known in ancient Magadhi language as Panya, or in Sanskrit as Prajna. This new eye brings in a lot more knowledge about us and reality without thinking. This is much more powerful eye compared to the five senses and memory. And not only can it see reality, but also beyond reality, which is Nibbana. The knowledge from this eye arises from within and does not use information from outside or the mind. As you will understand, this eye of Panya or Prajna and the thought process along with the activity of the mind can never exist together. Although it is translated as the eye of wisdom in English, I would rather use the word Panya or Prajna, because wisdom is used as a common word in day-to-day communications for a lot of other things, particularly ones connected with the thought process. So Buddha is not a person, but only a state of supreme knowledge, where one lives in complete knowledge of reality and Nibbana. Nibbana or Nirvana is a state beyond reality, which is calm, serene and happy. The happiness of Nibbana is not subjected to fluctuations of mundane life. It arises from within, remains permanent and present throughout life. In fact, in Nibbana, including its happiness, there is no past, present or future, but just supramundane knowledge or Buddha. Therefore, the state of Buddha is a timeless state. In certain traditions of Buddhism, it is said that the word refers to a person called Buddha. In fact, the person we commonly refer to as Gautama Buddha, born about 2600 years ago, never referred to himself as Buddha. He referred to himself as Tathagata, which has a deeper meaning. Reference to him as the Buddha is therefore strictly a misnomer. This reference has taken our focus away from reality. 2600 years ago, Gautama Buddha clearly explained that in reality there is no person as such existing in the space of the human body. This concept of Buddha as a person has somewhat undermined or put to a back seat the real meaning of this calm, serene, happy state of supreme intelligence. In spite of the fact that the Buddha message is beyond thought, those who see Buddha as a person do so by using their five senses, thought process and the mind, contrary to what Gautama Buddha preached. A very important cardinal fact of his message is known as Cheto Vimukti, which means release from the thought process. Now that we have some understanding about the state of Buddha, we will move on to the question as to why we need such a high level of intelligence. Why cannot we live as we are, within the scope of five senses and the mind, generating thoughts and being creative, even if they are illusions? This is a question everybody should ask themselves before proceeding any further. Firstly, there is a thing called duality of nature. And as we are part of this very same nature, we are subjected to and influenced by phenomena arising from this duality. What actually is duality in a Buddhist sense? It means two opposite ends of anything, any phenomena of nature. Examples are light and darkness, up and down, good and bad, long and short. Scientists may call matter and antimatter. It is the same for past and future. Happiness and sorrow is also part of this very same duality. Thoughts and thought process are always influenced by duality. When Nibbana or Supreme Intelligence is reached, however, there is no duality, and therefore there will be no sorrow or happiness arising from a thought, as thoughts are conquered and abolished. Instead, there will be supramundane happiness, which is not generated in the mind and therefore not subjected to waxing and waning, but permanent as the mind is conquered and disposed of during the path to Nibbana. Secondly, to live in ultimate supreme knowledge, knowing what is happening within us and around us at the very basic fundamental level is happiness of knowing the truth. From the day we are born, we search and search, investigate nature, but unfortunately, at a very early age after being born, when the five senses and the mind start functioning, we are diverted towards illusion and move away from reality. On the contrary, in supreme intelligence, or Nibbana, or Nirvana, we move away from illusion and understand, experience and see, without thinking, the reality and ultimate truth beyond which there is no more knowledge to be obtained. Thirdly, to live in safety. Nibbana is a timeless state and has no past, future or present. This will invade invariably lead to a life in safety. Those who wish to explore further before venturing out, the first thing they should know is the exact meaning of the word Buddha. Without this knowledge, you will be lost in the wild, as many have done in the past 2100 years. So in summary, Buddha in a strict sense is not a person but a state of supramundane knowledge or supreme intelligence arisen from within, also known as Nibbana or Nirvana. Attaining such a state will lead to a timeless, happy life in safety, without fluctuations, and with complete knowledge or insight, free from illusions of thought, with the elusive troublemaker, the mind conquered. Who will not want that kind of life? No matter what your religion is, no matter what your education is, no matter where you come from, every human being is capable of conquering the mind and attain supreme intelligence. By now, you would have understood the process of attaining intelligence is actually not a religion or a prescribed way of life with a code of conduct, faiths, beliefs, and worship, contrary to what preachers of some branches of Buddhism make it out to be. It is not another ism. It is all about reaching a calm, serene, happy, knowledgeable state of living in safety. In my next talk, I will discuss the meaning of the word Buddhism.